everybody. Thanks for coming. My name is Uri Dromi. I run the Jerusalem Press Club. You all received the Dr. Flug's CV, so I skipped some of it, but she's been with the Bank of Israel for some years, served as the deputy governor, and since November 2013, she's been the governor of the Bank of Israel. She received her MA cum laude in economics from the Hebrew University and her PhD in economics from Columbia University. She worked at the IMF for a while and also the Inter-American Development Bank, so she has international experience, of course, as well. And she participated in a couple of important committees like the Trachtenberg, Baudet, and others. And the topic today is, as you see here, the Israeli economy, current trends and policies. And Dr. Flug, thank you very much for coming. And the floor is yours.
Thank you, and it's a pleasure to be here again. And I'll start with the current state of the economy, then talk a little bit about the main strengths and the main challenges of the economy, sort of looking from a longer term perspective. And then if we have time, I'll say a few words about the initiative to enhance competition in the financial system, in the financial sector, and a few words about the discussion around this topic. And then we'll have some time for questions and answers. So let me start with the current state of the economy. I would say that the Israeli economy is performing reasonably well given the state of the global economy. What one can see from this chart, which shows the GDP per capita or growth per capita, looking at different groups of economies, you can see that Israel, which is here depicted in the blue line, is generally very much part of the global economy, and we're growing somewhere in between, for most of the time, between the higher growth rate of the developing economies and the lower growth rate of the advanced economies. And generally, our business cycles are very much related, tied to the business cycle of the global economy. What we can also see that in the last 2 years, we've seen some deceleration of the growth rate, and actually the GDP per capita over the last 2 years has grown at a pace of roughly half a percentage point in each of the last 2 years, and that's actually slower than the average growth rate in the advanced economies. So we've seen deceleration and quite a moderate growth. The main reason for this deceleration of the growth rate is the fact that the global economy, and Israel is a small open economy, a very open economy, is the a slowdown in the growth of world trade. World trade actually is a reflection of the demand for our exports, and generally our exports are very well correlated with the growth of world trade. In the last year, actually, 2015, the exports performed somewhat worse than growth of world trade, partly as a result of some specific companies that had some difficulties, and also there is some effect of the strengthening of the currency that also meant actually that Israeli companies had harder time to compete in global markets. So overall, there is a strong relationship, but in the last year, we've seen some lower performance of exports. To a large extent, that was was compensated by high growth of private consumption. So private consumption grew at a fairly strong pace, and that to a large extent offset the weakness of exports. The labor market is doing quite well. Actually, what we see here is that unemployment has declined to a low level. It's unemployment of people aged 25 to 64 is roughly at 4.5%, which is low historically and also is low compared to other advanced economies. And that has happened, or this decline in unemployment occurred in spite of an increase in the participation in the labor force. So we see a continued people joining the labor force, increase in participation, and a sufficiently strong increase in employment so as to have also a decline in unemployment. Most of the new jobs occurred in services, broadly in private services and also in what we call the public services, which are the education, health, and other services. If we look a little bit deeper into the labor market, what we see is, I mentioned that we've seen an increase in the participation rate. We see an increase in participation and in employment also of groups that used to have and still have a relatively low participation rate. The two groups that stand out in their very low participation rate are Arab women and ultra-Orthodox men. Arab women are depicted in green on the left-hand side, and you can see a gradual increase there, although still the level is low. Their employment rate is roughly 30%, compared to close to 80% of the Jewish non-ultra-Orthodox women. By the way, the employment rate of women that are not Arab and not ultra-Orthodox is significantly higher than the average in the advanced economies. And we also see among ultra-Orthodox men a gradual increase in the rate of employment, but still it's only about half the rate of Jewish non-ultra-Orthodox men. So you can see here the trends. The trend is positive, but these are very gradual processes. But to go back to the macro, in spite of the fact that there is an increase in the participation rate, we've seen sufficient strength of the creation of new jobs so as to absorb the new entrants to the labor market together with a decline in the unemployment rate. Another aspect of the relative strength of the labor market is the increase in wages. You can see here the trend, generally the trend of wages is very much tied to the business cycle, and in the last 2 years, and more so in the last year, we see some acceleration in the growth of wages, both in the business sector and in the public sector, where actually the recent agreement in the public sector in a way mimics the trend of wages in the business sector, and you see that both of them have grown over the last 2 years, and over the last year, growth rate was about 3%, which means that given the very low inflation, actually negative inflation, it's even more in terms of real wages. So we see a fairly strong labor market. So this is part of the background that we see when we are thinking about our monetary policy, and let me say a few words about monetary policy now. The Bank of Israel's policy objectives are defined in the Bank of Israel law from 2010, and they include as a central goal the maintenance of price stability, where price stability is defined as an inflation which is between 1 and 3%, like in many advanced economies. And subject to achieving that goal, the policy is expected to support the economic objectives of the government, including growth, employment, and reducing social gaps. And also, we're expected to support the stability of the financial system. So this is the framework in which monetary policy is conducted. And I already, at the beginning, showed where we see the economy in terms of the real side. And let me now go over the main considerations, the main other considerations behind monetary policy. So the first variable to look at is inflation. As you all know, inflation has been very low. In fact, it has been negative over the last 12 months. So in the last 12 months, the CPI declined by 1%. So we're clearly below the price stability or the inflation target. When we look a little bit inside the development of prices, what we see is that the headline inflation, as I mentioned, shows a 1% decline. But when we look at what are the main drivers of this decline in prices, we can see at the corner on the right-hand side the development over the last 12 months of commodity prices and energy prices. And as you all know, energy prices have declined very, very sharply. And also commodity prices have been declining. And that has affected the inflation in most advanced economies, also in Europe, in the US, and in other economies. In addition to these exogenous or external factors, in Israel, we've also had some decisions of the government to reduce prices, or that result in a reduction in prices, and these include the decline in VAT, the decline in some other administered prices. If we sort of take out these decisions and the direct effect of energy prices, and we look at the CPI net of these effects, excluding these effects, so the CPI excluding these factors actually increased by 0.7%, still under our target, but there is a big difference between the overall evolution of the the consumer price index and the prices or the evolution of prices excluding these specific factors. It's also clear that also the rest of the CPI is affected by the decline in energy, because when we exclude the energy, we exclude only the direct effect. And it also affects the cost of production in all other items. So clearly, there is a depressing effect of these items on the CPI. And I would say generally that there are clearly very positive effects of these decline in prices. And when we think about monetary policy, we're not trying to correct these declines, but we look forward and we sort of look through these effects and see whether inflation, excluding these exogenous factors or one-offs, is expected to go back to the target level. And you've seen earlier the effects of all the trending prices. We think that this is an indication that the economy is supporting, I would say, a return of inflation to the target level after will wash off. Now, an important consideration when we think about monetary policy is what are the expectations for inflation ahead? And it's a whether the inflation target is well anchored. And what we see here is that in spite of the current very low inflation, and even though we still have in the pipeline some further decline in prices resulting from some further reductions in prices of public transportation and water, decisions that have just been taken by the government, and some further decline in energy prices that has not yet affected prices but is expected to affect them in the near future, we see that longer-term expectations are well anchored around, not very far from the midpoint of the inflation target, which means that people believe that the inflation targeting regime is credible, and that after this short-term effect will end, we will actually be back in the inflation target. Okay. One very important variable that we look at when we think about monetary policy is the exchange rate, and it's important both for inflation when the exchange rate is, or when the shekel is strengthening, that has a dampening effect on prices, but it's also very important in terms of the competitiveness of the Israeli trade system. Okay. So, as I said, the exchange rate is an important factor in affecting both the dynamics of prices and also the dynamics of the real economy, because it actually has an effect on the competitiveness of the Israeli tradable sector. And a challenge that we've faced over the last year, actually longer than 1 year, is the relative strengthening of the Israeli shekel. Over the last 12 months, it actually stabilized against the US dollar, but the shekel strengthened against the weakening euro, which means that Israeli companies have harder time competing with European companies and exporting to Europe, and that's an important part of our destinations in terms of our exports. So that's an important variable which we also take into account in our monetary policy. I mentioned that one of our goals of policy objective is the financial system, or the stability of the financial system. And one of the concerns over the last few years have been housing prices. In terms of monetary policy, the concern is thinking about financial stability, but obviously affordability to the fact that housing prices have been rising very rapidly over the last few years. From the point of view of financial stability, we're also concerned with the continuous expansion of the volume of mortgages, and the fact that mortgages have become a very large part of overall credit given by banks is also a concern, and we're concerned about really the ability in case of some. So these are sort of the elements that are behind our thinking about policy. So in terms of activity, we're at a moderate activity. The labor market is in good shape. Inflation is generally very subdued, and housing prices and mortgages are expanding. And that basically led to the combination of policy tools that we have been using. So in terms of interest rate, the Monetary Policy Committee has decided to keep interest rate at 0.1%, which is very low. And we also made it known that our assessment is that monetary policy will remain very accommodative for a considerable period of time. So we expect to be in this very low interest rate for quite a while. So that's one, or I would say one main component of our policy. Another component of our policy has been our foreign exchange intervention, and here there are actually two parts to our policy. One is that we've been purchasing foreign exchange so as to offset the effect towards appreciation of the fact that we started producing natural gas, which on itself actually exerts further pressure towards appreciation of the shekel. And we also have been intervening occasionally in the foreign exchange market again to try and offset some of the excessive pressures towards appreciation of the currency, which, as I said, we think that is that the currency is overvalued. The third element of our policy has been to introduce several limitations on mortgages to try and make sure that people actually don't take risks that would make it difficult for them to actually repay their mortgages. And here you can see in the lower part of this graph the series of measures that we've introduced, which we call together macroprudential measures, which basically are aimed at making sure that the risks of mortgages are not excessive. And these include limits on the share within each mortgage that can be taken at a variable rate. There is a limit on the loan to value. There is a limit on the level of payment to income, and so on, so on and so forth. And we actually see that the mortgages became, each mortgage became less, was lower risk because they meet all these important criteria. So this is basically the set of policies that the Bank of Israel has been has used in order to meet the sort of target, the very challenging task of bringing inflation or making sure that inflation will go back to its target level over within 24 months, by the way, this is how it's specified in the law, and also supporting activity and supporting financial stability. Let me maybe move on to some sort of longer term issues with the Israeli economy, and I want to start with few areas in which I think the Israeli economy is particularly strong, or what is behind the strengths of some of the sectors of the Israeli economy. So one important factor behind our comparative advantage in high-tech sectors in general is the very highly educated labor force. When we look at people aged 25 to 64, the share of people with tertiary level education is 46%, and as you see, it's very high compared to other countries. By the way, we had a huge contribution from the former Soviet Union immigration over the 90s that I think had a major contribution to this picture. Another attribute of our strength, again, which is behind the strengths in the high-tech sector, is the very high national expenditure in research and development, the highest share among advanced economies of GDP. By the way, most of this R&D is performed by the business sector, and the contribution of the public sector is relatively modest. It had been much higher in the past, but right now it's actually partly a reflection of the fact that this very high-tech sector is also investing a lot in R&D. Another, I think, important attribute of the Israeli economy is the high level, innovation, And actually, what I show here is Israel's ranking in two different international rankings of innovation of different economies. And in one of them, in Bloomberg, it's ranked fifth, and in the World Economic Forum, it's ranked third as the third most innovative economy. And you can see underneath the main factors behind the very high ranking of Israel as an innovating country. And part of it is the quality of our universities and the technological abilities within our research institutions. Part of it is the very strong collaboration between universities and the industry, the government support for R&D, and other factors. But this is certainly an important attribute of the innovative economy that is reflected in the startup nation, I would say. When we look at the productivity of Israeli industry compared to the productivity within the same sectors of other advanced economies, there are some areas in which we're particularly strong. Again, the areas which are benefiting from our comparative advantage in the highly educated labor force, in the high research and development. And you can see there some of the sectors, including optical, medical equipment, chemicals, and some other high-tech industries which are highly high in terms of their relative productivity compared to the same sectors in other advanced economies. So this is the half full glass, but we also have some serious challenges, and let me point to some of those. We saw that in some sectors the Israeli economy is highly productive, or output per hour or per worker is relatively high. But when we look at the economy as a whole, what we see is that our productivity is substantially lower than that of the US, and also substantially lower than that in the average OECD country. And what I think is at least as concerning is the fact that we're not actually closing the gap. So the growth of productivity, or the growth of output per worker on average, is actually slower than in the US. And this is actually the second part of the same picture. There are some sectors in which we have a particularly low productivity, particularly low output per worker. And those are generally sectors that are inward looking, that are less exposed to global competition. And at the lowest point, we can see the construction sector. It's a very local sector. It has been very much dependent on very, I would say, non-advanced technological ways of production, aided by the availability of low-cost workers. We imported foreign workers to work in the construction industry, and that actually allowed the constructors to continue using ancient methods, I can say. And that's actually a sector that really there is a quite substantial room for improvement of productivity. But generally, the sectors that are not exposed to external competition are the ones that have a relatively low productivity. One reflection of the fact that we have this division in the economy of the high productivity sectors and low productivity sectors, one of the effects of that is also the high level of inequality, income inequality in Israel. And I guess that it has also to do with the diversity of the population. We've seen at the beginning the very different rates of participation of different groups in terms of the labor market, different level of skills, and all of that is also reflected in the high level of inequality. And I don't know whether I have time for a few words on the competition in the I can stop here and take questions, or
let's start with questions, but then feel free to incorporate your remarks into the answers.
No problem.
Thank you very much. Okay, wait for the mic, and we can give them the slides if they want, right?
Sure.
Okay, so anybody, just approach Raya, and you'll get the slides if you wish. Questions?
Jean-Michel Rignan, Interpress. Just a slight, small question, but I have a larger question. What would you consider proper rate for the euro to the shekel?
I don't talk
about
the dollar.
Yeah. And the second one is, you talk about productivity. What is the position of the Bank of Israel regarding eventually the Sunday rest compared to the installation of the Sunday?
So I don't think I have an answer of what is the appropriate rate. All I can say that we think that the current rate, at the current rate, the Israeli shekel is somewhat overvalued. But I think there is a wide range of models that show different deviations from an equilibrium level of exchange rate. But all of them, or most of them, point to some overvaluation of the exchange rate. Regarding the Sunday rest, we haven't actually looked at it recently, so I don't think I have a position that I can now refer to.
Yes, Christian.
Hans-Christian Rössler, Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung. You mentioned Haredi employment, and you sounded slightly disappointed that there is not such a big increase in participation, especially of Haredi men. What will be the effect on the Israeli economy, on economic growth, if the government doesn't succeed? There's a target for men, I think, something like 63% within the next 4 years. So how much does the low employment rate of Haredi men affect Israeli economic growth?
I think it's a strategic challenge that we don't have the option not succeeding. I think that given the demographic trends that implied the share of ultra-Orthodox in the population will grow substantially over the next 20 or 30 years, I think their integration is crucial for them and for the Israeli economy. And I think there is much more openness now in the ultra-Orthodox society to integrate into the labor market. And I think we have to work hard on making sure that they have the adequate skills that can really help them integrate in a successful way. So there are two issues. One is getting into the labor market, and the other is really being equipped with the skills that will really provide them with gainful employment, with adequate wage. I think we have to work on both. When I look not over the next very few years, but over the longer run, I think it's we don't have an option of not actually tackling that problem.
Yes, so can I ask a follow-up question, Andy Friedman from the Jerusalem Report magazine? So on a political level, what is the Bank of Israel, or how is the Bank of Israel engaging the Haredi world, politicians, rabbis, community leaders? in order to affect those changes? And what support are you getting from the government? That's for the prime minister and his coalition. That's a bit of a minefield. How are you negotiating and navigating those issues?
Generally, on economic matters, the Bank of Israel is an economic advisor to the government, and the government takes the decisions. I think there is a recognition by the government, by not only this government, but also previous governments, of the importance of improving the employment situation in the ultra-Orthodox sector. By the way, I did not point earlier, but if you look at the ultra-Orthodox women, there is a huge increase over the last, 15 years. It's really dramatic. It's the group that has increased its employment the most. And they're now not far from employment levels in the rest, in the secular population. And there are a lot of programs actually which are aimed at enhancing the skills both of ultra-Orthodox women and men, but I think we have to do more, and we're actually pointing these things out in order to encourage the process and the strengthening of this process. But I think so. My sense is that there is an interest of the Haredi world to get, the Haredi world is a very diverse world, but I think there are large parts of that world that are interested in actually integrating into the labor market.
Yes, please.
Aviva Wanderer, Israeli TV, community television. Has the boycott on Israeli products affected the economy in this last year?
From what we can see so far, we actually don't see in the macro numbers an effect. I think that so far, I think there are some, publicized episodes or occurrences, but in terms of the overall effect, we don't see those in the numbers. But a small open economy potentially, it could have an effect. We don't see that in the number now.
Okay, you had some more points that you wanted to make.
I could. Okay, a few words about a discussion that actually takes place now regarding the financial system. And as you probably know, there had been a committee that was set by the Minister of Finance and myself that is supposed to look at ways to enhance the competition in the credit market, particularly regarding households and small and medium businesses. So before getting into the recommendations, let me say a few words about the structure of the financial system, and then we'll get into the recommendations. So there is a large banking sector, which is a relatively conservative, provides a high level of services, and has a very tight supervision and regulation. It performed well during the global financial crisis. We didn't have any failures in the banking system in Israel. And it has a, I would say, strong competition in credit provision to large companies, and it's actually dominant in the provision of credit to small and medium enterprises and to households. And then there is a non-banking part of the financial sector, which developed relatively rapidly. There has been a rapid evolution of the corporate bond market. before the global financial crisis, and also direct lending by institutional investors have increased rapidly over the last few years. During the global financial crisis, we've seen some, I would say, difficulties in the corporate bond market, which actually froze during the crisis, and the regulation on that actually lagged behind the development of that sector. And following the financial crisis, we've seen a strengthening of the regulation there. If we look at the overall distribution of credit by source, about half is provided by banks, and the rest is provided by foreign lenders, by bonds or corporate bonds, and tradable and non-tradable corporate bonds. When we look at households, the main source of credit is the banking sector, and that's true also for small businesses. And it's true regarding mortgages, which is almost exclusively banks, and also banks are very dominant in non-housing loans. So this is the structure. And so generally, I would say that the segment that is where there is room to enhance competition is the retail segments. And we've taken, the Bank of Israel and the banking supervision has taken a number of steps to try and enhance the competition within the banking sector. By the way, it's very competitive regarding mortgages. The spreads in mortgages are very, very narrow. But we've also tried to enhance competition in other retail credit. And the main steps I listed here are the fact that we made it easier for people to move from one bank to another. We made it easier to open accounts through the internet. Actually now banks are required to give customers what we call an identity card, which basically gives the basic information about their financial situation, and that it's in a standard way that should make it easier for people to shop for loans in different entities. We reduced some of the fees and also made some what we call fee tracks that allow people to get basic bank services for very low fee. And we required the banks to give in a very transparent and standard way information about interest rates, about fees, and so on and so forth. There are some other major reforms on the agenda that should also enhance competition in that sector. One is creating a data registered and credit bureaus that should provide people with credit score that should help them actually shop for lower credit costs among banks and non-bank sources of credit. We're trying to promote the use of securitization that would help actually fund credit also using capital from institutional investors. The fintech in general, the development of fintech reduces the barriers for the introduction of non-bank entities into the financial into financial services provision. And we're taking several measures to try and promote efficiency in the improving efficiency in the financial sector. And this has been done as a long-term process, recognizing that there is a need to enhance the competition in the banking sector and from outside of the banking sector vis-a-vis the banking sector. these measures are, or some of them have already been taken, and some of them are being are in the process of being taken or legislated. Some of them would require complicated legislation, and we work together with the Ministry of Finance and with other partners to move in that direction. There are the committee that I mentioned before, the what we call the Sturm Committee, which is the committee to increase the competition in the banking and financial services, has come up with a report, with an initial report, with several important measures that will also contribute to enhancing competition. And on some of those recommendations, there is a broad agreement, and there are several recommendations on which there are various opinions. So the recommendations that are that on which there are broad agreements in the various players in that committee are regarding the need to increase the number of participants in the financial sector and in the provision of credit, the number of providers of credit. And one way of doing that would be to separate the two large credit companies from the two largest banks, and this way creating separate entities that will compete with the banks on the provision of credit to households and small businesses. Another measure that has been agreed on is to actually adjust the requirement, the regulatory requirement from different credit providers to the level of risks, which would mean that the requirements from, let's say, those credit card companies after their separation from the banks will be somewhat less restrictive compared to the requirements that are on banks, given that they don't take deposits, and in that sense they're exposed to different risks or somewhat of a lesser risk. Other recommendations of that committee are for the promotion of technological platforms that would help customers to compare the level of services and prices between different credit providers. And there is also a recommendation to advance the deposit insurance that should, as a side effect, have a benefit for the smaller banks that people would feel more comfortable with those banks. So these are the recommendations that are agreed upon, and we think that if all of them are actually implemented, that would support the enhancement of competition within the credit market in the segments where there is less competition at the moment. We think that doing that would expand the sources of credit to non-bank entities, but it's very important that the standards of the provision of these credits will be maintained in terms of the both in terms of the protection of consumers and also in terms of prudential supervision. It's important not to create an arbitrary regulatory arbitrage between the different providers of credit. We think that generally the supervision should be risk adjusted. I mentioned before the different level of the different requirements according to the level of risk, and it's important to complement these reform with the setting up of a financial stability committee that will be an important element in the coordination among the different supervisor of measures and the monitoring of risks that should be monitored and addressed early. So these were the few words. comments I wanted to say about the financial stability.
Yes. Wait for the mic.
Hi, Steve Shea with Reuters. I wanted to ask, back on the economy and interest rates. The United States has already started to raise interest rates. Europe is still very low, and they're not going anywhere anytime soon. Do you see a scenario? What would be a scenario for any change in interest rates in either direction this year? I know that the bank doesn't expect anything until at least the fourth quarter. Do you see anything this year or maybe next year? And the second question is, are you afraid, are you concerned about this China contagion spreading further, and that would obviously hurt Israel's economy? Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, so I think that the decoupling of the interest rate policy or monetary policy in the two major blocks is a development that will have an effect on Israel, but we will have to monitor the effect as to what it actually does to the main variables that concern us. So I think that given that we're not part of any of the blocks, we will really have to see what is the dominant effect before we decide in which direction our policy will move. And we will look at what it means in terms of our activity, what it means in terms of our inflation, what it means in terms of the evolution of our exchange rate, and we will act according to the effects on the Israeli economy. And it's hard to say at the moment what will be the dominant effect. Regarding China, we are not directly exposed to the developments in the Chinese economy, but we're certainly exposed to the effects of the to the potential effects of the Chinese economy on the main economies that we have economic ties with. So we will have to monitor to which extent the developments in China, and right now we talk mostly about the developments in the stock market in China, whether it has an effect. It has, we've already seen an effect on the stock prices in the rest of the global economy, but the question will be whether it goes beyond the correction in the stock market prices and whether it has an effect on the real economy. I think it's too early to say something about that.
What effects the FATCA and the OECD new regulations have had or will have in the future in Israel?
The main effect is that Israeli banks have to basically follow the rules of the new rules of the game, and we've seen also, it's the effect of the FATCA, and it's also the effect of the way the U.S. authorities actually the results of the Bank Leumi, how is it called, fine, and I think that it made it clearer that banks have to have, and they do have, white money policy, and they have to basically adjust to the way that cross-border risks are enhanced and can materialize. And I think they've been they've definitely internalized the new rules of the game.
We have one rule that we keep here, and that's 1 hour rule. So thank you very much for an excellent presentation and for coming. I want to thank your able staff for facilitating it. I want to thank our people, Linda, Hannah, Yoav, Kobi, Raya. And before you go, I want to give you something that's